You have no room for note-taking, but I did intend for you to take some gems away from today. So as you may find some opportunities to write something down, maybe record it on your phone, maybe notate it on a napkin or something, that may be appropriate. But as I start, I'd like to begin with just the simple question of who you are. I'm very familiar with SHRM. I applaud you for being members of SHRM. And as such, I trust that it's been a worthwhile membership, because I do believe that, as it's a cliché-ish statement, you're involved with managing and working with the greatest asset within any of the companies you work with. So as you're doing so, your role is quite significant. So I'm curious as to the attendance here. How large are the companies that we have present? So I'm going to ask just some questions to get raises of hands, just so that I can get a good feel for who it is I'm speaking with. First of all, from a management perspective, the organizations that you operate, how many managers are you actually responsible and interacting with that oversee the employees within the company? So I'm going to start with managers 10 or fewer. Anyone? All right. 11 to 50. 50 or more. Okay, good. So let's look at employee size. How many of you are working in companies that have fewer than 20 employees? Can't imagine anyone else. Okay, how many of you are with companies 21 to 100 employees? Just a few. How many of you are 101 to 500 employees?
Is this per location that we're responsible for?
No, just that you're responsible for. That you're responsible for. So you could be with like an international company with branches everywhere. You're just working with a central location. How many of you are working with a location wherein you're responsible for employees that are 501 or more? Excellent. Okay, good. So I really do believe that the principles we're going to be discussing today apply to each of your organizations. Those of you who have smaller groups admittedly may have an easier way to implement what we're going to discuss today. So those of you who are larger, this is perhaps something that you can mull over and consider for the coming year. But either way, I'm sure you're going to take some gems from this discussion as we're trying to create stars in your organization, okay? Now, I do have a disadvantage. My clicker, for whatever reason, Murphy's Law, it doesn't work. So you're going to see that I'm wandering over to the laptop about every so often to advance the slide. Forgive me for that. I hope it's not a distraction. But regardless, it has to be done. So the first thing you need to recognize is, in business, this is a formula that everyone kind of throws around, and it doesn't really apply to your organization because you're working in the human resource element. But I'm sure with your role, you're seeing this discussion going on, that there is a profit to be made, and there's numerous ways to kind of look at the same formula, which is the business is bringing in revenue, there's cost to do that work, whatever's left over is the profit. But what we want to recognize and what we want to discuss today is it's more than that. It is something that's personal. You're interacting with individuals. They have very specific needs, and they have very specific personalities. So we have to be sensitive in the roles that you're each running to what it is that they're needing so that they can perform at their best, okay? So that we can, as they're on payroll, as they're working, they're performing as they most likely or best can. So we want to change it and look at it from being a personal to a personnel issue. And I think you'll agree with me that because it is personnel, it's your responsibility. It's always going to come back to you to how they are going to perform. And in your culture, do you have the means to get the most out of everyone? Okay? Now, with that being said, what we're going to be discussing today are these following objectives. We're going to be looking at mapping your business. We're going to be talking about, as it states here, the STAR training program. How do you create STARs in your organization? We'll identify four ways that you can use to motivate employees, but we're also going to address ways that you can hold them accountable. And as you're doing this, make sure that they're doing what they're paid to do. But then lastly, we're going to talk about the back office. Oh, you're going to do that for me. So I'm just going to say, next. And you can either hit that or the enter button, and it works. Thank you, sir. All right, so with that in mind, what we're going to look at, first of all, is mapping the business. So in mapping the business, every single company is made up of these three organizations: marketing, accounting, and production. So in order to understand them, what I want you to do is realize how they correlate. So next. I'm snapping at you. All right, so what we're looking for here is how these interact. each of your companies are performing at different levels of profitability, okay? How intimately aware you are of those numbers, whether or not the company is profitable, I don't know. It varies organization to organization. But I do want you to understand, even though if you don't know the number, the correlation. The correlation is simply this. The more these three groups work together, the more the profit occurs within the organization. And so that convergence, that dark area in the center, is literally where the profit is made within an organization. When you have outlying groups where there is no collaboration, where the employees do not work together, the management do not work together, you will find it as hard, if not impossible, to then be profitable. So our job, what your role is trying to facilitate this cohesiveness, okay? So let me define what each of these are so that you can understand what each or represents. Marketing, accounting, production. Let's go to the next one. Marketing is going to be every individual department that is involved in things preceding the actual transaction. So everything up to and including the transaction. That's marketing. Once that transaction occurs, we're going to refer to that as production. It's the fulfillment of whatever product or service you deliver. But as a company, there's also accounting. And I do not mean just the financial, accounting, profit and loss, balance sheet stuff. I'm talking about in every organization, you have things that you track quantifiably by numbers. You have numbers that are going on. Are people hitting deadlines? Are people producing at a certain level? Meeting certain expectations? That's all tracked from an accounting point of view. You have people in your organizations that are good with numbers, and their job is to track and make sure everything is being accounted for. Those are the three types of organizations that exist in any business. Even in a sole proprietor, they have to look at their company this way, okay? So let me just give you a little story here to kind of put this into context. Worked with a client, they actually had a product that they were selling. And as they sold it, they understood in the sales department that it was the most profitable product that they had to sell. So they got all excited and they were going to do in the next quarter a promotion. Now the promotion was designed to sell the thing that made the most money. How are we doing so far? We're doing good, right? Smart, right? If you're in the marketing department, it's like, you're thinking. So now what happened is they did not know that over in the production side, they had actually had new arrangements with vendors so that the cost to fulfill that sale had gone up. So the product, the material used to fulfill the sales, no longer cost the same. Same, it was a lot more. What really had changed is that there were discounts by the vendor to get them as a client that were quite substantial, hence the large profit margin. But that substantial savings no longer existed. So that vendor no longer was giving them that sweet deal to get that client. They now had signed the contract. They were getting the product at a more expected norm. Did sales know about this change?
No.
No. They were told about all the successes they were having selling it before. Hey, go sell more of it. Production failed to say, by the way, we've signed the contract. Everything's costing more. By the way, the margins aren't the same. They didn't communicate it. So the sale goes. Sales are coming in, revenue's going, everyone's busy, right? Sales are up, revenue's up, everyone's happy and busy. It was in the accounting department more than three months later that people started running the numbers, and guess what they found out? Every time they sold the product at the discounted price that they were offering it for, they were losing money. The failure of those three organizations talking together caused a problem. Second example, working with a construction company, they go out and do bids. In giving out bids, one of the biggest components of what that cost will be to do the work is the labor, okay? So they're going out doing construction work, it's all this man hour that's going on to do the work itself. This is where you come in. The accounting department, HR, payroll, was aware of the fact that at the end of the year, payroll increases occurred. Now, I know it's not common to necessarily go around and tell everybody what everyone's making. I get that. But as an organization, they recognize we have to tell the people going out and giving the bids that the cost to do this, the labor, has gone up in our company. The costs to do this are not the same as they were last year. So HR, accounting, communicated to those going out and giving the bids that the coming year was going to cost more in labor. So it's not that everybody knew what everyone was making. Nobody knew about the promotion pay increases that occurred, the 10-year payroll increases, the cost of living increases. But overall, they knew what those were so that they could properly go out and do the bid. Did they avert a problem? They did, a huge one. If this was not communicated from the accounting department to the marketing department when the bids were going to be made for the coming year, it literally would have been 6 months to almost a year before they would have realized they were losing money, if not taking themselves out of business. So that's how critical this communication is. So let's go to the next slide. One of the things I would encourage you to do is in your organization, try to facilitate this collaboration. I have seen in organizations where these outliers occur because you have management that doesn't like to work together. They choke. In fact, they become competitive and they don't want the other one to win, right? They don't want them to achieve whatever they're doing. So there's this infighting. So what we want to do is we want to try to avoid that. So I'm going to just real quickly share with you a first gem of how to perhaps conduct a meeting. These are some components you can bring to the table that will allow you to have more profitable, more productive meeting discussions. First of all, in your agenda, there needs to be a level of accountability in every department. Every meeting must have occurred for a reason. So if it's occurred for a reason, it's safe to assume that from that meeting, action items have come. Somebody's supposed to leave there with something to do. That, if you didn't meet for that reason, why were you meeting, right? So every meeting must have had some outcome associated with it. So what we're going to then say is that outcome, the next time we meet, needs to have some return and report element. The meeting needs to begin with, so what happened? You were asked to do something. Can you give us an update? Is it done? Is it progressing? How's it going? They need to feel accountable for that. The other part of this is you need to hold them to standards. The more clear you can set the expectations, such as the deliverable, the outcome, the timeline, the more clear it's understood what's expected of them. Okay? The next thing that you have down is vision. There was a study done a number of years ago, and there's numerous case studies that demonstrate this, that whenever a person knows the why behind it, they're more inclined to do what's asked of them. So I'm going to share with you a silly little case study that I think is somewhat apropos to this. They did a study where back in the day, when there used to be the common office copy machine, the Xerox machine, So what would happen is, generally, everyone would not send the orders necessarily there, but they would bring the one sheet that they needed to copy. I need 100 of this, I need 50 of this, I need 20 of this, right? They'd bring the sheets and they'd stand in a line. And in these large organizations at the time, they found that if a line formed, they could test, could someone jump into the very front of the line and get a job done? Well, what they found is the majority of the time when someone came to the front and said nothing other than, I need to make some copies, well, guess what everyone else was standing in line for?
Me too.
Go to the back, right? So you'd run up with the haste, I need to make some copies. I need to make them quick. You'd say, get behind me. But when they came up and they said, because, and gave the reason why, more than 80% of the time, even though all these people were waiting, everyone would say, oh yeah, go ahead, you can do it. The because was, is typically they'd walk up and say, there's a board meeting going on, and they need the copies, and they've asked that I bring them to them real quickly. And everyone hearing the why would say, yeah, go right ahead. Anytime you can in business give a person the reason why, they're more inclined to feel that there's a level of accountability and responsibility. I have something to contribute. I can make a difference, right? So that's where you want the vision. The social, here's the thing that's really interesting. How many of you have been to a meeting, and it can't be this one, by the way. How many of you have been to a meeting, and you sat through the meeting, and you wonder, why in the world am I here? Why am I here? Why did they invite me? What am I supposed to do here? When you're running the meeting, help those people not experience that. The first way you do that is everyone has to speak. So whenever a topic comes up, at the end of the meeting, if someone has not participated, you need to turn and say, Heidi, what are your thoughts on this? Can you help me? What point of view do you have on this? So that Heidi doesn't leave the meeting as if she feels there was no reason to be there. I'm so glad I got your name at the beginning. So with that, everyone speaks. The other part of this is you also have in the meetings people that are common or comfortable speaking. And there's others that kind of don't speak unless spoken to kind of a deal.
you need to give them a voice. You need to let them speak up, because they may want to say something, but they just don't know how to interject. They don't know how to maybe properly kind of get involved in a conversation. You need to invite them into that and give them that space. And that's how you'll do this. If you follow this meeting agenda, you will actually help this cohesion, actually occur. So with that in mind, I'm gonna now change gears and go to another topic. But the theme I want you to leave with is this. Go to the next slide. Calm and collaborate. If you're working together as an organization, again, those orbs come together, profits in the center, and you're more inclined within your companies to make the money that you're there to make, okay? So let's go to the next subject. Got a quote here, it's about culture. Would you agree that your roles are pretty key to the culture that exists within your organizations? Everyone should be nodding. So here's what I'd like to add. Not only is your role key, I think of the roles or the influence that you can have, you're one of the most influential. In other words, if I took, since I know Heidi's name, if I took Heidi and I replaced her over here, Charles, right? And I replaced them in the two companies. Let's say they just, for whatever reason, changed roles in the companies. Two different people in two different companies. Do you think 6 months to a year later the culture would change? Yes, they have that much influence. You have that much influence. So even though there's a president of the company, even though there's managers, even though there's employees, you can dictate a lot of what's happening in setting up policies, expectations, and what people can expect to experience as part of the culture in the company. So let's go past this to the next slide and talk about the STAR program. We're gonna create STARs. We've been doing this since 2006 with companies, and it's worked very well. I'm gonna share it with you today. It is definitely something that can be implemented in your companies with a little bit more attention. I can't imagine that today is enough to actually implement this, so don't think I'm presuming that much. But I would like to share with you what this is so you can see what it looks like and how it could apply in your company. First of all, STAR is an acronym. STAR does stand for setting standards of performance, trusting the people. It does acknowledge them for what they've done and reward them as well. The T element is made up of three T's, the tools, the training, and the temperament. We're gonna go through each of these in a little bit of detail. But before I do, I want you to read this quote. So Charles, go to the next one. This one here, I think, really speaks well to what we're talking about in your organizations. It says, effective teamwork will not take place of knowing how to do their job. They still have to be trained. And it's not gonna, or how to manage the work. They still need help with your, or management, prioritizing what needs to be done first. But poor teamwork, however, can prevent effective final performance, and it can also prevent team members from gaining satisfaction in being a member of a team and the organization. So that's what we're trying to cause here, okay? So let's go to the first slide. The first thing we want to do in setting standards is make sure everyone has what's called a key metric. And this is shown in a dash, oh, go to the next slide. You went forward, there you go.
There you go.
So the first thing we want to do is setting standards, the S in STAR, is we want to have what's called a dashboard. How many of you in your companies currently have a dashboard of some sort that's visually displayed within the company of some metric? About just under half, okay. I'm a huge proponent of dashboards. Dashboards are a visual representation of the workflow that's going on. Now in some companies, you're actually going to have workflow where it's made up of literally at this moment what's happening in the company. So like if you go to a call center, they might have wait times for people that are in the queue to be taken as customer service calls. In other companies, you'll have things that represent daily performance or weekly performance, maybe even monthly performance. Every company may differ, but regardless, you need to have a dashboard. And the way the dashboard needs to be created, and those of you who already have them maybe have some insights for us, but what we're looking at here is a visual representation of the key things that everyone needs to be doing. Every department must have what's called a key metric. Every individual must have a key metric. And I'll be very clear here. Of doing this as much as I have, I've only found one role in a company that I've struggled to find a metric for. And it's programming, IT people. It's eluded me for years. I have yet to figure out how you actually create a metric for that IT individual that's involved with the programming. But literally, I've yet to find any other role where you cannot define that one metric that says at the end of the day or at the end of the week, did they do their job? That one thing. We all need to have that. Beyond that, you need to visually display it so everyone else sees it. Okay? So company and individual. So if you go to the next slide, here's the rule of thumb that I usually begin with when I'm working with clients so that they can understand how to actually define this for themselves in their companies. The first is every company has departments, marketing, accounting, production at the very least. Every one of those need to then have a key metric. Every individual in the company needs to have a key metric. That key metric, if it were done, if it were achieved, should then mean if we look at the financials, we're profitable. If they do that one thing, we're profitable. If they do that one thing, they're doing their job that they were hired to do. Now, everyone's job is more than just one thing, obviously. So what we want to do is break it down then to three key supporting metrics that these things help them achieve that one metric. Those are what we're looking at here. Every department would have that in every individual. So let me give you an example of how this works. Sales is typically the easiest to start with. So generally in a sales department, it's quite common. You just begin with what are the number of sales they need to make. And if they got them, we know they're doing their job and we know we're going to be profitable. So in sales, you'll simply say, well, how many units do they need to sell either on a daily, weekly, or monthly basis? And as long as they're hitting that number, they know they're doing their job. If they excel beyond it, they can get the bonuses and the spiffs. If they're below it, they know that there's going to be attention brought to them. Training, discipline, probation. But that threshold is known by everyone, and it's basically the same for the entire position. The same thing exists for management. If you're running at a management level, a department, and the department, the sum of those individuals with the few that are struggling and the few that are doing well, is as an average meeting the department mean, there's no reason for that upper management to delve deeper into that department. But if they're struggling and not hitting it, then that manager knows this is a department that needs some attention and I can go spend some time there and help them come up with what we can do to fix this. It might be hiring more people, it might be training more people, right? So what we're doing here is we're trying to identify how that looks. These standards, one of the key things is that they need to be visual. So if you go to the next slide, these are some of the scorecard things that you look at. You've got company ones, you've got the sales and marketing, you've probably got the production or service. It's each of these people and departments having that key metric. Now, if you go to the next slide, this is how some people will show them in dashboards, the visualization of how it looks. If you go to the next slide, I'll give you another one. Some people want to see kind of everything at a glance, where this here, for example, is mine. It actually shows here's what the standard is, here's what's actually going on, but more important, it's going to show the deviation and how long it's been going. Because if it's going on for a long period of time, I know very quickly where I need to put my time and attention. Because if something's at standard, check, I can move on. The administrative department, of the three things that they're needing to do, there's two out of the three that are fine. One's 2 weeks old, well, I'm gonna look at something, what's more important? Well, I've got a 3 week old thing up there that's needing more attention. I know as a manager what I need to be focusing on. If I were an employee, I could easily look at this and go, what do I need to focus on individually because this is within my realm of control. So go to the next thing. So that's setting the standard. So let's go down to trust. There are three things every one of your employees actually need in order to be successful. You need them. You need the tools, you need the training, and you need the temperament. So let's talk first about tools. In every one of your roles, you'll have responsibilities that involve technology, right? Whether it be computers or machinery, there's something going on there, something that they use to do their job. If that tool breaks down, it needs to be fixed. Would you agree? How about this? The company invests all this time, energy, and money to buy a new tool, but nobody gets trained on how to use the tool. So management's all excited about the investment that they just put in to buy this wonderful equipment. Nobody's trained on how to use it, and management's going crazy with why aren't things improving or getting better? It's because no one's been trained on it yet. Temperament. You can have employees where, granted, in the work environment, everyone seems to be working well. It's not a hostile work environment. But outside of work, they've got drama going on. Can that drama come in as a temperament and affect their interest in doing their job? Yeah, they're distracted. So what we want to do is we want to find out when an employee is doing well, what's causing it? Is it the tool they now have? Is it the training they receive? Well, let's duplicate that. But when they're struggling, what we want to also recognize is their training needed? Does everyone else have a different tool than they have?
Are they still using the old computer system? Maybe it's one department and another department in two different locations. One company's got new tools, or one office has new tools, the other one doesn't. Is there any wonder why they're not performing at the same levels? The last being temperament. That's why you do the sociable things that I'm sure your prep's doing. That's where you do the awards, the recognitions, because you're trying to maintain a good morale within the company. But you also have to recognize, you have to keep a pulse on, is there anything out there distracting them or frustrating them? Family health issues, right? Family employment issues. These things can only impact that level. So let's go to the next slide. This quote here is the same, well, no. I pulled it from earlier, so let's read this one. It says, the key elements in the art of working together are how to deal with change, how to deal with conflict, how to reach our potential. The needs of the team are best met when we meet individuals, or meet the needs of individual persons. So often I think what happens is when you're working in larger organizations like you have, you fail to actually get to know all of your employees as individuals. That's a challenge that I feel each of you are going to have, and how you try to address that, I don't know. But I'm going to encourage you to address it, to get to know them on a one-on-one basis. So what we're going to do now is I'm going to share with you some tools that you can use to quickly, whether it be in the year review process, the annual review that you're doing with your clients, or maybe it's when they're coming in for other reasons, you're going to use the following things to help identify who these people are as individuals. What makes them tick? So let's go to the next slide. The STAR program and setting standards and having these tools, what we have here are five ways to motivate employees. If you're not already doing all five of these, I would encourage you to write down the ones now that you're not doing. So you've got obviously things that you can do to listen. What way do your employees have to communicate to the company, to management, ideas, suggestions, just a line of communication? Showing gratitude. When things go right, how does the company communicate at an individual level and a departmental level some level of gratitude? Celebrate. How do you celebrate your company's successes? So often in companies, what happens is you'll achieve a milestone, a success, but then everybody's busy to go again to the next milestone, and the one that you're celebrating or should celebrate actually occurred a month ago. You're just now aware of it because the numbers are out. So it's kind of like, well, that's old news. Yeah, we did it, great, but we can't stop now to celebrate, we gotta move on. So everyone's achieving things, but nobody's celebrating, right? The other is develop employees, what kind of training's going on there, and acknowledging your staff. So let's go to the next slide. I'm gonna give you some things to actually focus on these right here. So the next slide. You actually have people that will fall into four categories, and they will move, but 9 times out of 10, when you take them on as an employee, they'll be who they are here for the duration of employment with you. Okay, so people will change because of age. So if you've got someone that's been employed with the company maybe 20 years, you might see them move in here. You'll see why. But generally speaking, once you've identified them, they're pretty consistent as to who they are. Most people are motivated by either time, money, recognition, or altruism. I'm going to tell you right now, the least of these is going to be altruism in your group. So they do exist. They may actually exist in your HR department, but rarely do they exist in companies, and you'll see why in just a moment. Let's talk about time. Think of yourself. If I came to you, let's say, what's your name?
Allison.
Let's say there was some big project right now that needed to be done this weekend. The weekend before the weekend of Christmas. Probably got some shopping to do, maybe a family party. And I'm coming to you and I'm saying, Allison, I know things are busy. I need you to work this weekend. I have to have you work this weekend. And I'm gonna come and you get why it's important. You understand, it's not a shock. But I want to give her a reason to do this that she feels appreciated doing. Because I know Allison, she's going to do it anyways. She understands the importance of it. And she's going to do it. But I want to acknowledge to you that I recognize this is a sacrifice when you're going out of your way, and I'm appreciative of it. But I want to do that. So I'm going to come to her and I'm going to say, you know what, I know time is something I can give you. I'm going to give you off next year an extra week paid vacation. Whenever you want, extra week paid vacation. Next year, you just have to work this weekend. This thing done. Now I say this to her, and she says in her mind, what did I do with an extra week of paid vacation? Oh, yeah, hold on a second. Imagine someone that has no hobbies, maybe no family. They're basically, you give them more time, they're like, what would I do? I wouldn't go skiing. I mean, it's cold outside. I'd go to sell, read a book. I don't want to read a book, I want to work.
sometimes the carrot that you're giving doesn't motivate that individual. So let's say I came to you with money, and I said, you know, I know this is a big deal, I'll just give you a bonus. I'll give you a bonus of $1,000. You work this weekend, put in the time, I'll have it to you for Christmas, I'll give it to you on Monday, you got $1,000. If she wasn't motivated by time, but by money, could you see how that might be more motivating to her? Okay? The next happens to be recognition. Let's assume I gave you money, you're not living paycheck to paycheck, you've got money, your last pay, now I realize this is old school, but it makes sense. Imagine that you still did payroll check-wise, right? When I was younger, I had a drawer full of checks that I hadn't cashed because I hadn't made it to the bank yet, all right? I know that's old school because it's direct deposit nowadays, but the analogy still applies of, you've got money, you don't need it, you just don't spend it on anything, right? You don't get the coffees, you don't get the sodas, you don't want the movies, you just work all day long. So money's not that big of a deal. Time, you wouldn't know what to do with it. But recognition? Imagine somebody who has a spouse who knows that they are going and doing all this extra work for the company, but the spouse just never sees that the company appreciates it. You're giving your heart and soul to this company. They don't care. They're just taking advantage of you. Knock it off. Come home. Spend time with the kids. But imagine you come back to them and you say, remember your name, Veronica. This is a big sacrifice. And working this weekend, I know it's going to affect probably some family social thing. I know your spouse is going to be upset. And I know you get it needs to be done. Why don't I do this? I'll give you a weekend up at Park City, the first weekend in January. You and your spouse can go up there, and I'll give you tickets to the theater. We'll give your kids and everybody a thing to go to Fat Cats and do bowling. I'm going to give you all these things so that you're the champion. The kids are going to love you. You get the employee parking space up front. The next meeting, at the monthly meeting, you're the employee of the month, and I'm telling you right now, you're the employee of the month. When we have the meeting, I'm going to announce in front of everybody that you're the employee of the month. So it wasn't the time, it wasn't the money. She wanted to know she's appreciated. Okay? So here's the thing. What makes each of your employees tick? I'm going to encourage you that when you have a chance to go through every one of your employees, and I realize you may have staff that's going to help with this and so forth, but the goal is in their files, help management by identifying what is it? Is it T? Are they motivated by time? Could we just give them a paid day off and they'll be happy? Could it be money? Could it be recognition? Okay, could we just, that's the person that has to be the employee of the month. Sally, if we made her employee of the month, she'd get up there, she'd be embarrassed, she'd blush, she doesn't want the attention. She doesn't want to be the star, right? She just wants to be left alone. You give her time off, she'd be happy. This is huge when you're trying to manage and motivate the employees you're working with. Let me talk about altruism. How many of you have employees and know someone, when they got their job done, what was your name again? Stacy, right? So Stacy, you get your job done. It was something you need to get done. We're all glad you did it. But this whole team of people right here are also working on some things that have to get done. And each individually isn't leaving the office until it's done. And Stacy's that altruistic person. When she's done, guess what she does? She goes over and helps. What's your name?
Steve.
She walks over and starts helping Steve. Steve gets done. He leaves, but what does Stacy do? She walks over and starts helping. What's your name again?
Brooke.
How many of you know somebody like this? They go out of their way. They self-sacrifice because they want everyone else to be happy. Okay? They're not doing this because they want recognition. They don't want this because they want time or money. They're just there because they love the company, they're loyal, they want to make a difference, and they'll go that extra mile. Well, how do you reward them? You reward them by putting in front of them opportunities to do that, because that's where they feel value. When everyone else sees that they're helping, they get their value from that. That's where they get rejuvenated. And as a company, you can sometimes give them those opportunities to do it. You put them in charge of the next company party. They're happy to do it. I can just charge them, do a party. I can plan for it, make everyone happy. That's who this person is, okay? So let's go to the next slide. There are things that are intrinsic and extrinsic. Who can tell me what intrinsic means?
Internal.
Internal, but it's also natural. Okay. What I'm looking for is natural. Yes, everyone says it. Intrinsic is also natural. Oh, because it says it.
Just defined it. That was all.
Because everyone would say internal, so I didn't want them to say internal anymore. Intrinsic. It's also natural. It's what comes natural. But what you also want to make sure in these rewards is not only that it's just comfortable and natural and fits your culture, but you also want to make sure that it's tangible, that there's something that they can get. Okay? Lots of people will be given something, and it just doesn't have anything. That's why you see people get certificates. That's why you see them give paper checks. I mean, which is better? Give a person a bonus and say, Allison, it'll be in your next payroll. They're like, great. I open up the pay stub and there it is. No, what they want is an extra check. They want something tangible that says they got it, right? Okay. So for example, I just did for our company a bonus. And talking to payroll's like, please don't have us do paper checks. We're out of paper checks. I don't want to have to go, because we just moved offices and we don't have checks with our new address, and they didn't. And we let our paper checks run out because we were getting the new ones, right? And they said, we don't have paper checks. I don't want to have to go to the bank. And I said, fine, how do you want to do it? They said, could you just please say it'll be on their next payroll? Well, the last thing I want to do is say, oh, everybody, you all have bonuses on your next paycheck, and enjoy. No, I wanted to give them something. So I did cards, and on the cards, I wrote down specifically what it was so that they could have it and see it and touch it, right? That's what we're talking about here. This right here can help you as you implement these things. So again, you're going to go back and hopefully do what with your employees?
Identify.
That's right, identify. T-R, what? M and A. All right, let's go to the next slide. Just real quickly, just does something that I'm sure you're familiar with. Maslow's hierarchy of needs. Does that look familiar? Mm-hmm. What you're looking at here is just a way of depicting it. Everyone down here, once they get to survival, wants safety. That's comfort in their employment. They just want to know they've got job security, okay? But once they know that they're appreciated and have job security, they want to feel like they're making a difference, that they're valued. And then once they're valued, they want to know that they're really important, that they actually can make that big difference, that they're a key employee, okay? What we want to do is, through these processes, help them elevate through that process so that they can experience that. That's where you're going to find that your employees become more loyal. And as they become more loyal, they're going to be more willing to go above and beyond and become overachievers. Okay? That's where you're going to get your payroll bang for your buck. Next one. This is SMART. I'm sure you're all familiar with this, so I just throw this in as a passing thing. As you work with your employees and you're trying to identify those key metrics, what we want to do is we want to make sure that they're specific, measurable, actionable, realistic, and time-bound goals. Okay? This is really key because sometimes I think what's happening in companies, and I'm sure this is old school, you're not doing it, but the old cliche is thing of work harder, work smarter, you're not working hard enough. Okay, let's break it down into chunks that they can actually implement, do, and then they can achieve them and be more realistic. Let's go to the next one. So I want to talk about the back office. When I do this presentation, one of the things that I find that's interesting, especially with SHRM, is there's the behind the scenes that goes on in a company that too often is overlooked and neglected. And interestingly enough, I consider HR part of that. You are so integral to the success of the company, and yet, because you're not out on the front line, it's not apparent. So here's my analogy to help you understand the value and importance of not only your role, but those like you within the company that are more on the fulfillment end, that the customers may not see, but yet you're integral to the success of the company. This is you and those like you. So here we go. In the military, I don't know, anyone served in the military? Anyone a veteran? No one? Okay. Hug a veteran. All right. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to understand that in the military, particularly the Army as an example, it's a 15-to-1 ratio to every shooter. So every time you hear about someone that's on the front line, the one that's carrying the gun, the one that's pulling the trigger, behind them is a team of individuals. And the only reason why that one person can do their job so well and focus on what needs to be done is because they know the 15 people are behind them. Who are the 15 people? You know who they are.
Supply lines, intelligence.
Supply lines. Look, they're going to run out of bullets at some time. They're going to need water, food, what else?
Community.
Chuck wire. They got to eat. What else?
Communication.
They've got to have a line of command. Where's the next thing I'm going to? There's somebody over here. Can I go around them? They need surveillance and communication. What else?
Radios.
Communication. How about medics?
Yeah.
I mean, if you're going to go into the line of fire, wouldn't it be kind of nice to think somebody's behind you, that if you get hit, somebody's going to take care of you, right? Okay, you got the medics. Here's the deal. In the military, there is a huge support mechanism for the front line, and that's what you are. When you're a salesperson, when you're somebody working with the customer, do you want to talk to the customer and try and resolve problems when you know there's a bunch of misfits behind you that can't get anything done in the company? Of course not. You want to stand at the front line with the customer and say, we take care of our customers. We value our customers. Our products are good. Our services are wonderful. And the only reason why they can say this is not because they're doing it, but because they know they've got a team of people behind them that were going to do it, right? So let's talk about this a little bit more. How does it look in your company? In yours, there's the obvious, but it's the family. Do you realize that when you hire a person, you're hiring the whole family? If the spouse doesn't like the company, is the employee going to stick around? If every time the employee goes home and the spouse nags at them, why are you still there? They don't like you. They don't pay you enough. If you get that, you think they're staying with you? Of course not. If the kids don't like the job that you have, what does your dad or mom do for a living? I don't know. You've got to make it cool and exciting. My mom, my dad works for, right? That's what you're looking for. So here's the deal. You keep them happy, you're going to be happy. So one of the things that we do at our company, just to give you an example, it's part of our culture, is when we hire a new employee, that new employee comes into a department. They're hired by one of the management. But when they come in, we take all the management and we go to dinner with the spouse. We bring them in and we do a monthly meeting. Now, we haven't hired for a while, so that monthly dinner doesn't happen as often. But whenever a new person comes in, the following month, management would take that person to dinner with their spouse. The spouse meets who all the key players are, and their spouses, by the way. Okay? So it's the president with their spouse. It's the manager with their spouse. Okay? It's the team manager with their spouse, and the new employees with their spouses. They're all coming together. It's a social environment. It's natural. Guess what happens when everyone leaves? Do you think the spouses have bought into, hey, you've hired onto a good company. I like the company. They're nice. They're sociable. They appreciate you. They're excited to work with you. Hey, this is going to be a good place for you. What more do you want from the spouse? They just gave you what you're looking for. The employee feels good about the decision to work with you. And then you can try and obviously create that same thing where you have corporate events where the spouses, the families are invited so that they feel like they're part of that business family, okay? Let's go to the next slide. So here are those things that you're looking at. You already mentioned the supply line, the medical, logistics, the command. You guys got it. This isn't foreign to us. Let's go to the next page. So we're going to break this down to front office and back office. Here's the definition. The front office is any employee that you know of that the customer sees and interacts with. That's the front one. That's the one that you want to make sure looks good, wears the uniform, acts right, speaks well, right? Everyone else can be a misfit. Not that they are, but they can. Okay? They can have the tattoos, the jewelry. I don't know what it is you're going to say in your culture is odd, but that's where they all exist, right? That's the hairdos. I don't know. So here's the thing. When you have your culture, you get to identify what that looks like. What's the image you're portraying to your customers? That's your front line, and then you got your back line, okay? So in your business, the thing you want to do is you want to go through, and in addition to marking whether or not the person is motivated by time, money, recognition, or they're altruistic, you also want to go through and mark, are they front office or back office? F or B, okay? Once you've done that, the next thing happens. Go to the next slide. What we're going to do is we're going to take these two groups and we're going to ask them a question. Go to the next slide. First of all, in three sentences or less, describe your position or role. They, in their own words, what do you do here? So I had an opportunity to work for a company, still there actually, that was owned by a gentleman who retired. And as he got older, so I've been with the same company now going on 17 years. The guy retired who owned it many years ago. And he'd come back in because his son took over the company, okay? So he'd come in to see his son, who's running the business, and he'd say to his son, so what do you do here? Because he was like so flabbergasted, the company had changed so much. He's like, what did you do here? But he knew me as well, so as he left his son, he'd come back into the hallway, and he'd go past my desk, he'd come in and say, he'd sit down, how are things? So what do you do here? I knew the guy. I mean, I worked with him, but he had no concept of what was going on. So it's nice to say this. When you go work, or when you go to a family party or a church social, and people say, what do you do? That's that answer right there. That's what you're looking for.
Now, I encourage you to go do this because here's what's going to happen. When they ask, in three sentences or less, describe yourself. In what way does your role positively impact customers, vendors, fellow employees? When you answer the question, if you were out of the office for a week, how could it negative? Now, this is assuming nobody else did your job. Even if somebody else knew how to do it, they were too busy, they couldn't, your job's going to go undone for a week. What's going to happen? Okay? Answer these questions. Now go to the next slide. Now you have the fellow employees answering the question. So let me share with you experience with this. Had the employees do this, had them write out what they thought their job was, what would happen if they... Now, it was great. It was a learning opportunity for us as management. Like, oh, crap, I forgot. When you're out of the office, that happens. I totally forgot about that. If you were gone sick tomorrow, I got to remember that that's what you got to do. So that was an insightful insight for me from a management point of view. But what was even more key was the fact that when I had that employee say it to the rest of the company, we sent it out in emails. We did this in an email. They all came back, and then we organized them. Here's everybody's responses. And we sent it out. But what was beautiful is when everyone came back about each other, the positive, supportive comments that everyone came back saying, you know what, Heidi, you're integral here. Heidi, love her. Her smile, she's great. She comes in. She's the life of the office. When she's gone, we notice. I don't know what it is. But the point is,
how am I doing? Keep going, keep going, keep going.
The point is when it comes out, I rarely sign anything negative. Everyone was very complimentary to say, you're key, you're important, I need you. And when you're that shooter out front and you've got this team behind you that's so cooperatively working together, they're collaborating, and you see it, it's very helpful, it's very rewarding. Now, I'm not getting at times, I've got 10 minutes. All right, here we go. We're doing it. Let's go to the next one. Nope, back up. Back up. So real quickly, we're good. We're on time. We're good. Sometimes, if you haven't noticed, I can get on a roll. And I can get on a soapbox, and then it just keeps going and going. All right. So here's where we're at. I want you to just quickly see the four things that I'm asking you to take.
There's ghosts, right?
The four things that I'm asking you to go back and with your company consider implementing. These are things that I truly believe can help you create a more dynamic, fluid culture to help everyone work together. One is map everyone out. Are they part of A, accounting, M, marketing, P, production? So everybody, they get an M, a P, or an A, right? You're going to dashboard. What's the key thing they have got to do in order for us to say their job's done? Okay? And then the other thing is are they motivated mostly by one of these things? If we had to tomorrow ask them to do something special, unexpected, but it needed to be done, how do we thank them and express to them appreciation while asking it of them? And then with number four, are they front or back office? And have them do that exercise of tell me in those three questions who you are, and then have everybody else answer the same thing. You do these four things, I think you'll experience something phenomenal in your business. Truly, truly do. I swear by it. Now, having said that, I'm going to share with you a bonus. I've still got time, so we're going to do it. I do this with all my presentations. It's something I throw in. So next slide. I always encourage this. It's my bonus item. I learned this years ago, and I try to share it with everyone I speak with because I think it makes a huge difference. You can work to live, or you can live to work. Which is it? Do you wake up every morning and the reason why you eat breakfast and get dressed is because you got to go to work? Or you go to work because that's how you live and you go out and because of your job you experience life? Okay? Which is it? Well, part of that, I encourage you to take vacations and time off. Now, I'm going to share with you something that may or may not exist in your organization, but it did exist in ours years ago. So in ours, we had PTO, personal time off. At the end of the year, if you had too much banked up, if you didn't use it, you lost it. Okay, we only rolled over so much. Okay, so there were some people that just never took time off. They weren't sick, so they'd hold on to it. And we realized as a company, we can't, when they get to a certain level, just keep banking it. And then they get like 6 months off paid. I mean, this is insane, all right? So in any case, what it was, we put this cap on there.
But then what we started to notice, and I was part of it as well, there was in the culture this attitude of, so, what's your name?
Rick.
Rick, how many days did you lose this year that you didn't roll over? You lost 9? Dude, I had 12. I lost 12 days that didn't roll over. Man, I worked so much harder than you. You slacking. I lost 12 days. You lost 9? Come on. It's this attitude of, you're not working as hard as I am, because I'm working all year long, and that vacation time that they gave me, the heck with that. Are you kidding me? One, that's how you're paid, right? Isn't that part of your payroll? Okay, so here's the point. You want to create an environment where it's encouraged and celebrated, and people live vicariously through other people's vacations. What's your name?
Barb.
Barb, what was the last vacation you went on?
I went on a cruise.
What was it? Where'd you go? Did you like it?
I had a
what did you like about it?
The sunshine, the sand.
It's warm, isn't it?
Yeah.
Did you love it?
I loved it.
Okay, did you love the staff?
Absolutely.
Did you love the meals?
Yeah.
Did you eat a lot?
Yeah.
Did you get a suntan?
Absolutely.
Guess what? I love cruising. That's my preferred vacation choice. I this is going to sound totally sacrilegious. I don't mean it sacrilegiously, but it comes across that way. If I died this very moment and I found myself on a cruise ship, I'd be happy. That's heaven. And I am not joking in any slightest. If I died and I just end up on a ship, I'm like, crap, are you kidding me? I just get to float around. People take care of me. I eat as much as I want. And I end up in some new place every time. And if there's a storm, they go around it. Boom! Kill me now! I'm dead! I love it! Cruising the bomb. My wife, we go on cruises, or go on vacations. What does the wife do? She's got to make the meal. She's got to keep everybody busy. She's got to pick up the room that we're in, the hotel, whatever. Even though the staff comes in, she's got to make it tidy. We're not messy, right? You got to clean the bed, you know, put the bed up a little bit. No, you go on a cruise, my wife unwinds. She doesn't care. The kids can go, come. Nobody's going to get lost. Nobody's going to fall over. I mean, just go. Dinner at 5 o'clock. I don't care where you go all day. You can be here at 5 o'clock eating dinner. Anyways, I can go on and on my cruises. Love it. All right? Was that your first?
No.
Oh, how many have you been on?
7 or 8.
Yes. Right? Okay. Anyway, my time's winding. I'm on a soapbox. I gotta get back into it. Okay. There you go. You gotta go on one. So studies have shown this. First of all, the big benefit out of the vacation, the time off, is not the vacation itself, unless you go cruising. What they have found is there's actually a high level anxiety when you actually go on the vacation. And when you experience the vacation, what happens is you typically put more into it than you should. You wake up earlier than you typically do at home. You stay up later than you normally do. You push your kids through Disney. No, we spent $100. We're not going home now. You're going to stay. You're going to like this ride. If you're dragging it everywhere, I mean, they're happy at home, Disney. They're miserable. Why? Because it's 10 o'clock and no, they close at 12. We're staying. So the point is vacations can typically be the anxiety. But it's the anticipation where you get your bang. 3 months prior to, 12 weeks prior, what happens is your adrenaline goes up, your enthusiasm for life goes up. Why? Because you're planning and you're saying, when we go on vacation, guess what? Are we doing Disney the first day? Are we doing, say, are we doing California Adventure? Are we going to Disney? Are we going to do SeaWorld over another? Oh, I love SeaWorld! SeaWorld! You get excited about it, not because of the fact that it's the vacation, it's before the vacation, okay? But everyone else, if you celebrate it, they live vicariously through it. Dude, I'm going on vacation at Florida. You've been to Florida before? What's it like? Where should I go? What should I do? And they talk about an hour of his vacation because he's been there. And they're excited because he went there 2 years ago. Dude, that's awesome. I want to go. Vacations. Let your people do them. Have a culture where you celebrate and encourage them. You know, you haven't gone on vacation for a while. When are you going next?
Where are you going? What, in
2 weeks? 2 weeks, where are you going? I've never been to Jamaica and I've been on nearly 20 cruises. I don't know why, but my boat doesn't go there. No way, Mom. Okay, so here's a recap. This is what we went over. My time is about shot. I've got like 2 minutes, so here we go. This is essentially the recap of it. Go to the next slide. I want your takeaway. I can't do the whole room. I'm going to try to. You got 2 minutes. I want one thing that's a takeaway for you that you would like to go back and try and implement. This meeting's not a waste. Don't just go here and go, well, that was kind of fun. At the end, you made me laugh. No, I want you to go home, go back to your desk and go, here's one thing I think we ought to do. And you're going to write it down if you haven't already, and you're going to try and do it. You're going to call me and ask for help to do it, maybe. Okay? What is it? We're going to start here.
deciding on their motivators. I struggled with that. Because I can assume their motivator, but it might not be their motivator.
Yep. Figure it out. There's ways to figure it out. Figure it out. And just put on their application. And then when you're working with management, you tell, hey, dude, you want them?
Yeah, that would be awesome.
Okay, let's do it.
The exact same.
Okay?
We're going to talk about vacations.
I will tell you about your vacation, okay?
The same motivation and how to do that.
Okay?
Write down what you do and what other people do.
I love that. The back office exercise, everyone writes down the, you'll learn tons from it. And the compliments that will come, because people don't say compliments to everybody, right? You get them to write it down and say, did you read it? And you do it anonymously, by the way. You do it anonymously, because that way people are honest. And they'll say about everyone the truth, and it's always positive. You rarely get, you'll get some, but that's because the person's a jerk anyways and they shouldn't work there. Oh, good. Right.
Mine was about figuring out what motivates.
Good.
Charles.
Motivates. Where do you?
I think it's important that I'm in accounting as well, so the profitability discs were important to me.
Okay, good.
I like the motivators as well, and we did personality assessments in 2014, so I'm hoping I can go back through those and find out what those are.
Hey, just put a letter. That's all you're doing. It's just one little thing on their file. You got to pull it out. Because you're going to have a manager walking in one day and saying, I can't get this person. I don't know how they click. I don't know what makes them work. I don't know how to get. And you go, well, I have my file. I see that they're this kind of person. Do you understand this? Good. Okay.
I would say that the list of the job description.
Oh, good, good. I was hoping you were going to say cruise, but I take the list. I love it.
No, yeah, that too. Vegas for New Year's.
There you go. Okay.
Motivators.
Okay.
I really like the dashboard.
Dashboard. Good.
Motivators.
Back to you.
Probably the job description.
Job, okay, good. I shouldn't be pointing, I should be gesturing.
I was thinking motivators.
Good.
I'm thinking motivators and vacations.
I love it.
Frontline and backline.
By the way, I think you're the first to say vacations for me, so thank you. Motivations in the back office description and everything? Okay, good.
I think vacations and how to make sure there's enough people cross-trained so when you return from your vacations, they're not.
Very true. That's what you should do. But the exercise is to ask the question, if you did not come, what would happen? One, they'll come away from it feeling appreciated because they're going to say, well, you need me here because look what would happen if I were gone. But two, you're also going to learn, okay, let's not make that happen. If something happens, let's make sure this gets done because they told you what it is that needs to be done. So very good. Yes.
I would go with recognition. Better recognition.
Good.
Recognition, you're talking about going out to
dinner
with families.
Yes.
The loss that would
have looked
better
for
what they really
want. Yeah. Yeah. If you can suck the family in, spouses, even the kids, dad's got the coolest job, mom, your boss is awesome. That's what you want. Yes.
Taking more time off.
More time off, thank you.
I would say descriptions.
Good.
The business model, making sure everybody knows what the others are doing.
Yeah. Good.
Vacations.
Good. Next.
It keeps on changing, so vacations, recognition.
You can say it all. I just wanted one of you to say it all. People, here's the deal. Vacations is a big deal, but everything else is as well. You can make a big difference in your business, and I do realize you need to go. If she excused herself, she said she'd leave early, so I accept that. Everything else I don't accept. But here's the thing. I hope that you came to this, not just be motivated, not like, oh, okay, I got my dues, somebody spoke, it was fun. I hope you come away with this as something that you can actionably take back to your office and use, and I hope that you choose to do that, because the holidays are upon us. You're going to leave here, get sucked back in. You're going to have to write down an action item, otherwise January 2nd, you're not going to get this done, people. Just do yourself a favor and acknowledge that. So to the next slide. I'm going to offer, there's a book called In the Black. It's actually very helpful in business. It talks about some of the things that we discussed here. If you'd like, you can send me an email, put on the subject line right there. It says SHRM offer. Here's what's going to happen. I love you, I truly do, but Todd here, I'll forward the email to him. He's going to reply to you with what it is, just because I've got another speaking engagement. I don't want to put this off. But there's a lot to be done with your company. I do speak with companies on this, and I go into businesses and actually will help them implement these strategies. If you're interested, reach out to me and ask, I think this is something that my company needs to hear. This is something that my team would benefit from, and I'd be happy to talk to you about how we may be able to bring this into your business. Go to the next slide. I also have on January 5th next week, a meeting from 8 to 10. It is in Salt Lake.
I know up here, up north, we don't like down south as much. I know the culture. And if it's past Bountiful, it's like, it's like, what the crap? It's like, you're going to Vegas. Like, no, you're not going to Vegas. But we are still in the same state, all right? You guys. But 8 to 10, January 5th, it's at the Salt Lake Community Campus. That's the Larry H. Miller one on 98 South. Yes, it's even past the middle of the valley right now. But it's a two-hour meeting. It's for people that would like to understand how to actually, in their business, build value in the company. So if you've got some management yourselves that would like to come, it's a great thing that I'd like to invite you to. If you'd like more information about it, just mention in your email to me with Schirmacher that you'd like to know more about the January 5th event, and I can just send you some information. I'd be happy to invite you for free. It is a $200 meeting, but you may come for free. I'm inviting you or whomever it is you'd like to attend to come. I will give you a code to register for free, okay? Thank you.
Person in the room.
Right there? Yes, Charles is a good man.